Back in our Father's Word, we're going to pick it up here in the fourth chapter of the great book of Luke, the light giver, verse 36, here in a moment. Christ has just visited his hometown, and naturally a prophet among his own is just not recognized. And that was the lesson he wanted you to know. Never be discouraged about seed planting, continue it. And then he had just cast out an evil spirit right out of the person, and they were trying to identify him. Naturally, why? Because the evil spirit was from above, as well as we all are, but they have memory of what happened there. And they recognized him and knew him. And it was not time yet that he be identified, that is to say, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Anointed One. And he told them to hold their peace. So we pick it up then in verse 36 as he continues beginning his ministry and gathering the disciples. Verse 36 reads, "And they were all amazed and spake among themselves, saying, What a word is this? For with authority and power he commandeth the unclean spirits, and they came out." I mean, they come out. There's no ifs, ands, or maybes. When he ordered them out, they went. And naturally, that's the way our Father was through the Son. He had that power and authority. 37, "And the fame of him went out into every place of the country round about." And naturally it would. They'd never seen anything like this before. 38, "And he arose out of the synagogue and entered into Simon's house. And Simon's wife's mother was taken with a great fever, and they besought him for her." And verse 39, "And he stood over her," that's a medical term peculiar to Luke, "and rebuked the fever. And it left her, and immediately she arose and ministered unto them." She went about her chores right there in the home. She was healed. I want you to know, you're going to discover in the remainder of this chapter that Christ both casts out demons and he also heals diseases. Many churches, unfortunately, without spiritual discernment, can take a person that is ill, let's say maybe a birth defect or something whereby they have seizures, and their spiritual discernment is not there, and they call it a demon. That just can wreck families and drive them away from a church, you know, because a seizure is not obviously to one that has spiritual discernment necessarily demonic. The person needs help. Prayer will heal, yes, but don't tell the family there is an evil spirit there when there isn't. That's why you need someone that truly has spiritual discernment. Verse 40 to continue. "Now when the sun was setting, all they that had any sick and divers diseases brought them unto him, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them," every last one of them. Now that's diseases. Now what else did he do? 41, keep it separate in your mind. "And devils also came out of many, crying out and saying, Thou art Christ, the Son of God. And he rebuked them, suffering them not to speak, for they knew that he was Christ." They knew that he was Christos, that he was the Anointed One of God. If you've seen the Son, you've seen the Father. They had no difficulty in recognizing who he was. But here you have both the healing of diseases and the casting out of evil spirits. But spiritual discernment to a person of God is able to discern which it is. Verse 40, simply by that discernment. 42, "And when it was day, he departed and went into a desert place, and the people sought him and came unto him and stayed him that he should not depart from them." I mean, here they've got their own physician, their own doctor, their own supplier. I mean, why let him go? Let's keep him with us. 43, "And he said unto them, I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent." In other words, that word was to go all the way around the world. And we thank God that He has given us platforms now that do go all the way around the world. And that good gospel, chapter by chapter and verse by verse, can be taught in that way. Verse 44 to complete. And He preached in the synagogues of Galilee, the circuit. He wasn't hiding out in the wilderness somewhere. It was public, and what He had to say, He said right downtown in the churches, as well as other groups, but always where there was a meeting, nothing in secret. It was open and nothing hidden. Didn't have to. Why? Because it was the Son of God. And not as some churches would have to do, as to pretend or hope. He produced. And when you truly follow Him, when you have that spiritual discernment, and when God gives you that gift of discernment, then it is still He that does the healing. Chapter 5, verse 1. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon Him to hear the word of God, that they were hungry, He stood by the lake of Gennesaret, that's to say the circuit also. 2. And He saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. They were through. They were hanging it up. They'd been fishing all night and hadn't caught a thing. And this was washing their nets and getting them prepared for the next day. Verse 3, and He entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, that's Simon Peter, and prayed Him that He would thrust out a little from the land. And He sat down and He taught the people out of the ship. This kind of, when He pulled away because of the throng of the people, it kind of made an amphitheater in this same particular valley. And He was able to speak to that multitude from this boat, this little ship. Verse 4. Now when He had left speaking, He said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. Now, Simon Peter is a commercial fisherman. He knows fishing. He's been out there all night. He hasn't caught a thing. And here, this one is telling him, get that net back, put it back in here, let's go out, cast her down. Always fish out of the right side of the boat, Christ will tell you, though. Never the left. And that's by whatever type of fishing you do. You always stay to the right. And but Peter's going to have a little word to say about this. I mean, that's his line. That's his business. So he answers in this manner. Verse 5, and Simon answering said unto him, Master, at least he could recognize the authority, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. If you insist on it, I'll do it. Verse 6, and when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fish, and their net break, or their net, it was so full it was about to break. That's a good translation. 7, and they beckoned unto their partners, which were in another ship, and that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships so that they began to sink, or they were nearly sinking. They were greedily brought in that catch. And here we see the mastery of our Father, that He's able to control whatever He so chooses. So don't you ever doubt Him. And naturally, the point is being made here. You listen to me and fish my way, and you will no longer be a fisher as you are, but a fisher of men. In other words, He is documenting the fact that He has the authority, and He wants them to follow Him. There's not going to be any altar call. There's not going to be any begging, but the very act itself, in knowing He had this power and authority, that would cause them to wish to follow him. So verse 8, as we continue. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' feet, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." I mean, he realized what was before him, and naturally all of us feel unworthy at times when we're before the very Savior himself. Peter was likewise, but it would be this same Peter, Simon, which Petra means rock, and it would be this rock. Christ is the rock the church was built on, but Peter was the rock, a movable rock that he utilized to execute the order and the command. But here you see humbleness in him. Verse 9, for he was astonished, and all that were with him at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. He controls everything, our Father does. Verse 10, and so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. They were commercial. And Jesus said unto Simon, fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. In other words, you are capable and able to come with me. Repent naturally and stop catching fish. You're going to fish for men. And it is in this way that we do fish for men. We use the truth as our bait, the Word of God, and we gently put the bait out, and when someone strikes it, you pull them in. With what? With the Word of God. Verse 11, and when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. There was no questions asked. They simply went with him. So as he built his disciples. Again, I would remind you, no altar calls, no begging, simply follow me. Verse 12, and it came to pass when he was in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, who seeing Jesus fell on his face and besought him, saying, Lord, what did he call him? Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Now, there's something very important here that you must understand. The man has already documented that he has faith. He didn't say, I wonder if you can. He said, I know you can if you will. You can heal my leprosy. Didn't have any doubt. So this showed the fact that he not only called him Lord, bowing to the mastery, but he also showed faith in knowing with that touch that he could be made whole. Verse 13, what did Christ do? And he put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately the leprosy departed from him. He was as clean as he could be. That's as it was. He not only controlled the nature itself, the fish, but he controlled this disease as well. Why? The man said he had faith. He said, if you will. He knew he could. And so he did. 14, and he charged him to tell no man, but go and show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing according as Moses commanded, for a testimony unto them. Them who? The priest. He's dealing with Leviticus chapter 14, verse 4. And I will summarize what it says verbally to you. Basically, what it says is to take two birds, to kill one, and put its blood on the other and set it free, which it was symbolic overall of the fact that Christ would shed his blood, and with us under his blood, we're set free. You're healed. Now, will the priest understand that? Possibly not. But that was the message they were supposed to derive from it. And again, it wasn't quite time that the full power of the ministry should be made known to all. And this is why he said, tell no man, but go down and tell the priest and let them figure that out and understand it. So it was his blood, Christ's blood, that would save the world of whomsoever would, that would believe upon him, could have remission of their sins. Just as Peter said he wasn't worthy, then with the presence of Christ, you are worthy. He has that forgiveness, that authority. And God uses whomever he chooses. 15, but so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed by him of their infirmities. You know, God's word, chapter by chapter and verse by verse, will do that. Multitudes want to hear it. They want that truth. They're hungry. They're starving in a troubled world, a world where the heathen rage. And that wonderful, soothing truth of his majesty through the letter he has sent to this world, but especially to his elect and people therein, whomsoever will, this Savior, that blood of his upon them, you're set free. Verse 16, and he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. Even though he healed, and he still prayed. He liked to commune, to think, to meditate. It does one good to have some alone time to meditate at times, to consider, and to meditate on the very word of God to bring a better understanding, which does not mean a deeper understanding if you have true wisdom, but to simplify the word as it is taught by the living God, whereby a child can understand it. That's true wisdom. Verse 17, and it came to pass on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by. This will probably be trouble. Which were come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem, I mean right downtown, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Now this is where the trouble can come in, is the reason they would all come down, I mean there was, these multitudes were coming from their churches. These multitudes who they like to keep under their control were getting action and results from this teacher. They were being healed by the Lord Jesus Christ. He was emptying out their churches. He was hurting them because truth always prevails. That's the beauty of teaching God's word. I'll say it again, truth, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, always wins. You can count on it. Why? Well, it's the word of God, right from his mouth, the instructions that he would give us. But here, you've got these people out there, they're investigating, okay? 18, and behold, men brought in a bed, a man which was taken with a palsy. He was paralyzed. And they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. They couldn't get him in the house. I mean, there were so many people around that they couldn't, with this man on his bed at this time, is what we would call a pallet today, you know, a bedroll. And he was on that roll, and they were carrying him like it was a stretcher. Okay. Verse 19. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went up on the housetop and let him down through the tiling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. What does this do? Now stop and think. They had to know of a certainty. This shows faith. That if they take the tiling off of this roof and let this one down, that Christ can heal him. That shows faith. Okay. The reason I'm not hammering but insisting that you see, faith has a great deal to do with the accomplishment of a healing. You got no faith, you got no healing, my friend. So this is how Christ could ascertain the fact that they had faith because of the trouble they went to bring this one before him. And continuing then with the next verse, verse 20. And when he saw their faith, that's how he could tell. He said unto him, Men, thy sins are forgiven thee. Uh-oh. You see, man can't forgive sins. God can. But you see, who do we have here? We have the Son of God, which is God, Emmanuel, God with us. He can forgive sins. But boy, is this going to upset the scribes and the Pharisees. Verse 21, and the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, Who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? Well, that's who he was. Emmanuel, God with us. 22, and when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he didn't have to worry about it, he answered and said unto them, What reason ye in your hearts? What are you thinking? 23, whether is easier to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Rise up and walk? Question. 24, but that you may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he said unto the sick of the palsy, that paralyzed one, I say unto thee, arise and take up thy couch and go into thine house. I mean, you know, that's quite a thing. I mean, this man is paralyzed. People know it. Been paralyzed a long time. Who's going to say something like that? Take up your bed and walk. They had to carry him in, had to let him down through the roof. 25, what happened though? Immediately he rose up before them and took up that whereon he lay and departed to his own house, glorifying God. There he rolled up that pallet, he put it under his arm, and he skips down the road glorifying God. He's no longer paralyzed, he's healed. And not only healed, but his sins are forgiven. Had a reason to glorify God. 26, and they were all amazed, and they glorified God, and were filled with fear, saying, We have seen strange things today. We have seen some very unusual things today. We've seen divine intervention. 27, and after these things, he went forth, and saw a publican named Levi sitting at the receipt of customs, and he said unto him, Follow me. Now, Levi, of course, maybe he was of the tribe of Levi, but this is Matthew. Okay. He'll be the author of the great book of Matthew, the first gospel. He's a tax collector. I mean, he's sitting there, I mean, collecting taxes. Christ simply walks up, no altar call, and says, Follow me. With authority, of course. 28, and he left all, rose up, and followed him. No questions asked. And what did he do at the same time? 29, and Levi made him a great feast in his own house. He was celebrating for the Lord Jesus Christ. And there was a great company of publicans and others that sat down with them. I mean, we've got sinners right here in our midst. Sinners are public servants. They certainly weren't holy Joes by any means. Verse 30. But their scribes, this their own that were among them, and Pharisees murmured against his disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with publicans and sinners?" Now, if there's anything that God dislikes, it's a self-righteous hypocrite. Okay, why? Well, God sent his election and others into the world to witness to sinners whereby they could be converted. Otherwise, what good are you? What good are you in the service of the living God if you're a self-righteous hypocrite and will never witness to a sinner? I can tell you what you're good for. You're good for nothing. That's why God dislikes self-righteous hypocrites. Well, brother, you don't understand. I'm so holy and I'm walking a straight line. If I make one little bobble, I'll fall off. There you show lack of faith. You're worthless. Our Father gives repentance to those that serve him. And nobody's perfect that I know of. And certainly a self-righteous hypocrite isn't. And unless you produce fruit, God's going to cut you off anyway. And how could you produce fruit if you never talk to a sinner? Verse 31. And Jesus answering said unto them, "They that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick." 32. "I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." And that is the commission. That is the Great Commission, one of them, is to bring sinners into the truth whereby we have a better world. And certainly old Matthew sitting here at this tax table and following him and having this celebration, I mean, he's going to be an apostle. He's going to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. So they're celebrating, he's happy. And he's going to touch many lives and bring many people that are ill, that is to say, that like faith, into the very presence of the living God. So, but that's why Christ came, was to help sinners. 33, and they said unto him, "Why do the disciples of John fast often and make prayers, and likewise the disciples of the Pharisees, but thine eat and drink?" Well, now you got to remember, the bridegroom is right there with them. They're going to have plenty to fast and pray about after he's crucified, if they don't understand what it's all about. But while he's with them, they can celebrate. 20:34, and he said unto them, "Can you make the children of the bride chamber fast?" I mean, we're celebrating while the bridegroom is with them. No, you don't fast then. Verse 35, "But the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, and then shall they fast in those days." That means after the crucifixion. 36, "And he spake also a parable unto them, no man putteth a piece of new garment upon an old. If otherwise, then both the new maketh a rent, and the piece that was taken out of the new agreeth not with the old." And this would take a little bit of understanding. Now we have fabric that is all pre-shrunk, and you don't have to worry about all that much. But back when we patched jeans, and that was a thing that was done, usually it was the knee. You could kind of judge a man by where his patches were, on his seat or his knees, one or the other. And you could kind of judge a man by where the patch went. Now, if you took a piece of new duckin or canvas and patched a knee with new where the other was old, stitcher all around, make a nice little patch, the first time you wash that garment, it's going to pucker up until it will rent it, till it will not be decent. It would have to be redone. And it's the same way with God's real truth. When you hit a self-righteous hypocrite with it, he's going to get all puckered up. Can't handle it. Can't handle the real true word of God because of his own fixed little narrow-minded hypocrisies. So there he gives an excellent parable. But then he gives another, 37, and no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottle shall perish. But new wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. Now, if you were to take the word bottles here, it would be wine skins, okay? Like you would take an animal and you would tie off the legs and the neck, and it would make a wine bottle. But you see, new skin will stretch. But an old skin is dried and set. You couldn't stretch it. It wouldn't give one iota for anything. It would burst. So new wine is still fermenting to a sense, and it will expand. And if you put it in an old bottle, that's to say an old dried, cured wine skin, when that fermentation takes place, it's going to bust that thing wide open and you're going to lose everything. But naturally, you put the new wine in the new skin, it gives, it's pliable, it can receive that truth. Just as a person, when you give them the new along with the Old Testament, and you give them that truth, then certainly they're able to give with it. One more verse to complete the chapter. 39, no man also, having drunk old wine straightway, desireth new, for he saith, the old is better. And so it is when one is really secure in God's word, then certainly there's nothing new under the sun when you have that truth. And the real truth, using the old and the new combined, joined together, creating a marriage between the old and the New Testaments. It's all the word of God. It is better. All right, don't miss the next lecture. Bless your heart. You listen a moment, won't you please? Okay, Virginia from California. Are women allowed to be pastors, to teach, to heal, to take out demons and so forth in Jesus' name? Why yes and why not? Well, it is written in Acts chapter 2 that both my sons and daughters shall prophesy and have old men with dreams and visions in the end time of God's elect. But I'm glad you added in Christ's name, because no man or woman can cast out demons. No man or woman can heal necessarily. That's why we ask in his name, because he's the one that does it always. There have been many women we just covered in this great book of Luke, Anna or Hannah, whichever you wish to pronounce correctly, in the temple serving 84 years, a prophetess. That's a teacher, okay? So be it. Okay, we got, who do I have here? Jericho. Did God create some individuals for the purpose of being destroyed, Satan's angels? And he did not create them for that purpose. They chose that lot themselves. The only people that are held in chains right now for destruction are the fallen angels. Why? Well, they were created equal with anyone else, had every right, but they left their place of habitation, and rather than choosing to be born of woman, they seduced woman. And therefore, that ended it for them. And as it is written in the first six verses of the book of Jude, that's they sealed their own death warrant there. They, incidentally, are the 7,000 in Revelation chapter 11 that die the moment Christ returns, because they're finished, over. It is over for them. Heather from Florida. When Satan comes to earth, will he be able to bring people to him supernaturally in the physical? For example, in the blink of an eye, or will he just appear in Jerusalem via media sources? Well, both, but that's going to spread like wildfire all the way around the world. But it is your, as it is written in Mark 13 and Matthew 24, it is your own family that will deliver you up to him, because they know you don't accept him when they believe it is Christ. They haven't learned that the false Christ comes first. Therefore, because they think he is Christ, they're going to say, my mother or father is a little confused. Would you please forgive them and bring them in and talk to them? He said, I'll be happy to. Antichrist sure will, and he'll try to convert you. It's a religious thing. It isn't what is usually pictured in movies of blood and gore. It's peace, a false peace, a false church, a false religion, and a false Christ. Jim from Missouri, if you have been misled with the teaching of God's word all your life here on earth, what side of the gulf will you be on when you die? Well, it will be according to how, you're asking me to judge, and I won't, because God is judge, but what is written in the book of life decides which side you go on. And it would be according to how one lived with what they had. Actually, there's no one able to do the unforgivable sin until after Antichrist appears on earth. Then only God's elect that know better can commit the unpardonable sin. So it really, it's what's written in the book of life determines which side of that gulf they go on. If they truly love the Lord, even though there were some other false teachings that never, for example, worshiping the false Christ, they didn't, because why? He wasn't here. So they're not guilty of that. So they're in good standing if they're already gone. If they're here when it happens and they worship Satan, that's a serious offense. Lucy from Texas, I am confused about Matthew 27, 51 through 53, especially 52, and the graves were opened and many bodies of the saints which slept arose. This was a one-time thing. John chapter 5, Christ let you know this was going to happen or appear to happen. We know that to be absent from this body is present with the Lord, but to document beyond any shadow of a doubt that Christ had defeated death, then there were graves outside of Jerusalem that it appeared opened, but God simply allowed those souls to come back and make that appearance in the city to document Christ had defeated death. I don't know why so many people still want to hang on that there is death when no one has died. Not even Satan has died yet. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. And when this flesh body dies, your spiritual body immediately doesn't die, goes back to the Father. Betty from Oklahoma, what is the name of the book? Is that Dr. Murray said has the Hebrew manuscripts? Thanks and God bless. I love learning God's word with Pastor Murray and Shepherd's Chapel. Well, thank you for that. I'm not sure at what level. If you have a Strong's Concordance, you actually word for word when you take it to the Hebrew, Greek, or Aramaic, you have it. But if you want truly a copy of the Hebrew manuscripts, we have in our library what we call a volume of books, Greens in a Linear, and it will give you a good Hebrew rendition of the Old Testament, and along with Aramaic in parts, and the Greek also. But if you're just a student that does not intend to learn the language, then certainly the Strong's Concordance will give you the Greek, Hebrew, or Aramaic word and will give you the translation rather than the transliteration thereof. Dorothy from Florida, thank you for you're so welcome. My question is, when Jesus returns and the dead in Christ returns with him, will their earthly bodies reunite with their spiritual bodies? Absolutely not. Our flesh bodies go back to dirt, and that's all they are. Okay. So there's, why would you want to reunite with an imperfection, which these bodies wither, they get old, they get ill, and your spiritual body doesn't. It's perfect. Age means nothing to it. Disease means nothing to it. So certainly, why would you want to pick up the old? No, I know many teachers teach that, but it's a false teaching. When you read Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 6 and 7, it says these bodies go back to dust, dirt, from whence they came. And the spiritual body goes back to the Father from whence it came. So you see, if you read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with verse 35, you should learn, you got two bodies. You have a spiritual body and you have a flesh body. And the spiritual body, excuse me, is far superior. Quite frankly, it is your real body. And so it is. Joseph from Pennsylvania, where in the Bible does it say Michael fights with Satan in heaven and casts him down? Revelation chapter 12, verses 6 and 7. That's when actually Satan comes down as the false Messiah. He, for one and all times, he's here on earth. And as a matter of fact, that's when the woe trumps come. Well, why would they be woe trumps? Because it's woe for those on earth that are ignorant of the fact that Satan, the Antichrist, comes at the sixth trump and Christ doesn't come until the seventh, because they're going to worship the false one, because he's going to have a revival, a church on every corner. He's going to have a chicken in every pot, pay off all bills. I mean, he's going to make it like heaven on earth, only it's the devil on earth. Alberta from California, is it possible for a man to become an apostle today? Well, what does the word apostle mean? It means a sent one. Well, God can send someone, but we still have the apostles of the Bible, and what they teach is the word of God, and God's word doesn't change. We grow in it, and the word is pregnant because man, as he grows, it grows. It grows to the fact that he is able to interpret more, with more understanding. And naturally, I have to say that God still sends people. Why? Because he chose his election before the foundations of the earth, and he foreordained them. But I feel it would be very, it would not make good sense for someone to claim to be an apostle, a sent one, perhaps. Daniel from New York, when was Jesus born? Jesus was born September the 29th. His conception took place December the 25th. When did the Holy Spirit begin dwelling with us? December the 25th, and we can celebrate that. But he was born on the first day of the great feast, Feast of Tabernacles, and he was circumcised on the final day, the 8th. And your companion Bibles, in the back you will have an appendix, 179, that gives you day for day and deed for deed. It's very interesting and probably will teach you more than you wanted to know about the birth of Christ. Bruce from South Carolina, what is the name of the man that God created on the 8th day? Where in the Bible is this? Well, it's on the 8th day, and his name was not Adam, but Eph-ha-Adam, a different man. And from him, he made a different woman. Mythology, and some scholars, to cover the fact of what actually happened, bring in Lilith and a few other ways, because it's obvious if you understand the Hebrew, there were people on the 6th day and people on the 8th day. So they say Adam had a wife named Lilith before he had Eve, which is false. It's not true. Brett from Vermont. What does the Bible say about organ donation. I want to be an organ donor, but I don't know what the Bible says about it. It doesn't mention it, but then there's nothing wrong with it. But using common sense, if these bodies go back to dust, and if an eye can be transplanted and give a blind person sight, what a wonderful thing that is. I know that God would not disapprove of that, or a kidney. When someone is on dialysis, if someone grants their kidneys and it gives somebody that new lease on life, how precious that is. That's a great gift. You will find nothing biblically against organ donation. Julie from Arkansas. When you die, does your spirit stay in the grave until Jesus comes back to claim his children, or does your spirit go on to heaven? If so, is your spirit active at that time, and are you waiting for God to get ready for us? No, you are conscious, cognate of what goes on. When we get to the 16th chapter of this great book of Luke, Jesus makes it very obvious what takes place. You go instantly to the Father. You don't go out here in some hole in the ground. Read the last few verses of St. John chapter 8. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Do you know something? Even Isaac is with him. Abraham is with him. Abraham's not dead. He's with the Father. Right there in paradise. And so are all your ancestors that have passed on before you on one side or the other of that gulf. But nobody is out here in a hole in the ground, only the flesh that goes back to dirt from whence it came. David from Minnesota. What exactly is Satan's de facto? Well, I think perhaps that I'm not understanding your question, so I will have to say, I think maybe you don't understand de facto. De facto is when somebody actually sets foot on earth by force. De facto can be by force. De jure is where somebody comes and it is theirs by right. Okay, Christ comes de jure, Satan comes de facto, which means he's absolutely, feet touches the earth and he is here in person. And when does that happen? Exactly at the sixth trump. Read Revelation chapter 9. It gives his name in both Hebrew and Greek. In Hebrew, Abaddon, and in the Greek, Apollyon, so that you can't make a mistake. And he's here, and the time has been shortened to 5 months, is all he's going to have. Troy from Illinois, where does our soul go if we don't accept Jesus Christ? Well, it's going to the wrong side of paradise, and it's going to be held there through the millennium. You will live through the millennium. And then if you still refuse to accept Christ at the end of the millennium, you're going into the lake of fire and you will simply be blotted out, not exist. Jerry from Minnesota, you indicate that in the next age we will be part of our husband's family. Does that mean if you were married to a lying fool, you misunderstood what I said, or what the word said? We have one husband, that is Christ. We do not give and take in marriage, even though you may know your husband. But if he was a lying fool, he won't be there anyway, okay? So you won't have to worry about it. I'm not judging him, but it's possible he wouldn't make the cut if he's truly that way, okay? So you, Misa, from North Carolina. In Matthew 27:9, could you please explain this verse for me? It states that Christ was given 30 Judas was given 30 pieces of silver for betraying Christ. And Judas throws that silver down in the temple, and they took that silver and purchased the potter's field. Potter's field is where they throw old pottery that's broken 1,000 pieces. The symbolism is this, that Christ's blood brought that where these old clay pots, bodies, people, can be broken in 1,000 pieces, and he can put you back together and give you a life meaningful where you're somebody. you can get it done, can-do type person. That was a burial place for the poor, and Christ, the price of his body in betrayal, purchased that field. That's what it means. But symbolically, it means Christ is our fixer-upper. He takes broken peoples and makes them well.